to destroy the works of the evil one, and the kingdom of darkness with light, and to rescue men from the law of sin. This is the gospel of Christ, to proclaim good news unto the poor.
The gospel of Christ, spreading the soul-saving message of Jesus. And now, Ben Bailey.
This is the gospel of Christ.
Fellowship one with another, and the blood of His Son, Jesus Christ, cleanses us from all sin. 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. Welcome to our study of the wonderful book of 1 John. The book of 1 John uniquely divides into two thoughts or two ideas. In chapters 1 and 2, John stresses that God and Jesus are light. God is light, Jesus is light. Therefore, the application is, if we're going to live with God, we must also walk in the light. Then in chapters 3 through 5, John illustrates for us that God is love. 1 John 4, verse 8, God is the epitome of love. Therefore, if God is love, we must walk our life in the path of His love. And so the book of 1 John, God is light, chapters 1 and 2, and chapters 3 through 5, God is love. You know, when we think about the idea of light, we need to understand that Jesus, that God, they are the real light of the world. 1 John 1, 7, if we walk in the light as He is in the light, there's the idea that God the Father, that Jesus the Son, that the Godhead is the source of light. Think about what Jesus said in John 8, verse 12. I am the light of the world. In a world that was steeped in darkness and sin, where unrighteousness was on every hand, Jesus came shining as a beacon of light. We know that God's Word is also a source of light. Psalm 119, 105, the Bible says, Your Word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. And so we have Jesus, the light of the world. We have the Word that came from God, that Word which is Jesus, John 1, 1 through 4. And we also know that God is the source, the fountain from which all light comes. Psalm 36, 9 says it this way, With you is the fountain of life, and in your light we see light. The only way that we can be a light in the world, the only way that we can really walk in light is to walk in the teaching of God and in the image of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Part of John's purpose is to convince his hearers that Jesus did really exist. Jesus does this, or John does this, by showing us the tangible nature of this light of the world. John is in a time when there are people who are denying the existence of Jesus. Jesus didn't really come in bodily human form. He was more like an apparition, and thus John, one of his purposes is to counteract that thought and show Jesus really came and He lived as the light of the world. Now, I want you to notice how John does that. Notice what 1 John 1 verse 1 teaches about the tangible nature of Jesus. The Bible says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and which our hands have handled concerning the life. That was the life that was manifested. John notes that you can know Jesus is real because He was heard, that which we heard. Well, how did they hear Him? They heard His preaching, not just the apostles, not just the disciples, but the common people did. Mark 12, verse 37 says of the preaching of Jesus, the common people heard Him gladly. They heard Jesus when He wept. John 11, verse 35, at the death of Lazarus. They heard Him cast out the demons in Mark chapter 5 when He commanded the demons to come out of Legion, and they went into the swine and ran over the seaside. There they heard Him do that. They heard Him pray to the Father. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. And they heard Jesus rebuke the Pharisees. Woe to you scribes and Pharisees, Jesus would say 7 or 8 times in Matthew 22 and 23. And so when we think about Jesus being real and John showing that Jesus is the real light of the world, Jesus was heard by multitudes of people, some who didn't even believe in Him. Jesus was also seen and looked upon, as John notes. The wise men in the manger saw Jesus at His birth. Multitudes of people in the land of Israel saw Jesus and looked upon Him. When Jesus fed the 5,000, multitudes saw Him. He was seen frequently by His disciples. Governmental leaders like Pilate saw Him. And according to 1 Corinthians 15, He was seen by over 500 brethren after His resurrection at once. And so Jesus was not only heard, He was seen, but as we think about Jesus and His tangible nature, He was also handled. He was touched, no doubt by His disciples. John, the beloved disciple, reclined in Jesus' lap. We know that evil men bound the hands of Jesus. Mark 15:1, they literally touched Him. Roman rulers beat Jesus. Matthew 27, they slapped Him, they bound Him, they whipped Him with cords. Jesus was handled by them. And Jesus was handled by Thomas. John chapter 20, verses 28 through 30, Thomas said, I'm not going to believe unless I can place my fingers in the hole in your side and your hands. And Jesus showed him that, and he said, My Lord and my God. John 20, verse 28, and so Jesus was heard by multitudes of people, seen, handled. He is truly the Word of life, and He did exist. Now, notice what 1 John 1, verse 2 says about this Jesus who is the Word of life. Look at this beautiful description. 1 John 1, verse 2 says, The life was manifest, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that the eternal life which was with the Father and was manifest to us, that is Jesus, the Word of life. This life, this Word of life was made known to mankind. Friend, when we think about Jesus, one of the most beautiful descriptions of Him is that He is life. He brought us the words of life. In John chapter 6, Jesus made some pretty difficult statements. Eat my flesh, drink my blood. Jesus was talking about not cannibalism, but rather bringing His life and His teaching into theirs. There were some difficult statements there. The Bible says some of the disciples decided to walk with Him no more. Jesus turned to the rest and said, You going to go away also? And here's what Peter said. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. In John 14, 6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. And so when we think about Jesus walking in His light, it means that we walk in the Word of life, which Jesus Himself brought to us. But you know, friend, this is not something we should begrudge. This is not something we should think is a bad thing to do. Walking in Jesus' light, following the Word of life, ought to bring us great joy. You know, that's one of the reasons John wrote 1 John. Notice what 1 John 1 verse 4 says. And friend, I want you to think about this. Being a Christian is not boring. Being a Christian is not something you've got to be sad about. It is the best, happiest life you could ever imagine. Look at 1 John 1 and notice verse 4. The Bible says, In these things we write to you. John said, we're writing about Jesus, the Word of life, His existence, notice, so that your joy may be full. Friend, when I come to realize Jesus did live, that He is the Word of life, that He offers everything I need to get to heaven, that brings great joy. It ought to thrill our souls to think about that. This is why Paul could say in occasions like where he was at in Philippi in Philippians 4 verse 4, Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say rejoice. This is why Paul and Barnabas in a prison in Acts chapter 16 verse 25 were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Jesus and the message of Jesus brings us great joy. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ to them. And Acts 8:8 says there was great joy. Where? In that whole city. Because of Jesus and His message and how it changed their lives and gave them hope. Think about Acts chapter 8, verses 47 through 49. Here Philip has taught the Ethiopian eunuch the gospel. They both gone out into the water. He baptized him. He came up out of the water. And the Bible says Philip saw him no more and he went on his way rejoicing. Friend, the message of Jesus brings rejoicing. It ought not to be anything to be sad about or to be disgruntled about. Being a Christian is the happiest, the best life you can ever live. Now, along this line, I want you to notice what John says in 1 John 1 verse 5 about God being the light and how light brings happiness to our life. Look at 1 John 1. Notice verse 5. The Bible says, This is the message which we have heard from Him and declare to you that God is light and in Him is no darkness at all. Light brings happiness. It brings joy. It makes things grow. It's powerful. And my friends, God is the source of that light. In Him is light and there's no darkness at all. Remember Psalm 36, verse 9? The psalmist said, with God is the fountain of life, and in your light we see light. The only way we can be a light in the world is as a reflection of the true light, God Himself. As a reflection of the Word of God being lived in our life. Psalm 119, 105. What's really behind the idea of God being light? Friend, this suggests the purity, the holiness, the righteous character of our God. Leviticus 11, verse 44, God said, be holy as He who called you is holy. We know that God's holiness is what demands that He separate Himself from sinners. Habakkuk 1, verses 12 and 13, God is of pure eyes and abhors evil and cannot look upon wickedness. We know that God does not lie. Titus 1, verse 2, we're living in hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised before time began. And we learn that it's impossible for God to lie. Hebrews 6 and verse 18, we take all the Bible says on that wonderful subject, and we know that God is the true source of holiness, that He is righteous, and that as we emulate His character, as we have the mind of Christ, Philippians 2 verse 5, as we walk in the footsteps of Jesus, we can walk in the light. And that's John's very next point. Notice 1 John 1 verses 6 and 7, since God is light, what's the application? We must walk in the light. Notice these beautiful words. John says, if we say that we've got fellowship with God, that we're at one with Him, and we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of His Son, Jesus Christ, cleanses us from all sin. You cannot, listen carefully, you cannot have fellowship, have oneness with God, who is the light, and walk in darkness. Friend, it is impossible for a person to claim to be a faithful child of God and walk in sin. The Bible tells us we're to abhor sin. Ephesians 5 verse 11, we're to have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. We are to come out from among them and be ye separate. 2 Corinthians 6 verses 14 through 17. We are to realize that sin separates us from God. Isaiah 59, 1 and 2, and sin brings spiritual death. Romans 6, 23, and therefore, if we're going to be in fellowship with God, we must walk in the light. 1 John 1, 7 again says, if, there's the condition. There is a condition to being like God, to being having eternal life, to being in the light. If we walk in the light, we have fellowship one with another. 3 John 4, John said, he had no greater joy than to know that his children were walking in the truth. What's it mean to walk in the light? Well, if Jesus is the light, if God is the light, and if the Word of God is the light, Psalm 119, 105, then it means that we are to pattern ourselves after the character, the nature of God as found in Scripture. Very simply means that we've got to walk according to the teaching of the Bible. Walking in the light, my friends, means that every day we're striving. That doesn't mean we're perfect. It means that every day we're striving to walk the way God wants us to. Matthew 7, 21, Jesus taught us that it's not just everybody who claims to do that that's right. Jesus said, not everybody who says, Lord, Lord's going to heaven, but he who does the will of the Father in heaven. Now again, we're not saying this is perfection. We do fall. We do sin. We do at times make mistakes. There's none righteous, no, not one. Romans 3, verse 10, but walking in the light is the mindset that I want to do the will of God. I'm going to try to walk in the teaching of Jesus to the best of my ability. And when I do get off the straight and narrow, notice what 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 and 9 says we must do. What does it really mean to walk in the light? Well, let's let John explain that to us. It doesn't mean that we're automatically forgiven of sin if we're walking in the light. There are things we must do to receive forgiveness. Notice 1 John 1, verses 8 and 9. John says, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Walking in the light means that we recognize we do sin. If we say that we have no sin, we're just tricking, deceiving ourselves and the truth is not in us. Friend, we have got to realize that we're not perfect. God is perfect. Jesus did not sin. He lived a perfect life, Hebrews 4:15, but we are not perfect. Part of walking in the light means we realize we are in sin. Romans 3:23, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Again, Romans 3 verse 10, there's none righteous, no, not one. Ecclesiastes 7 verse 20, the Bible says the most righteous do sin and fall from the grace of God. And so walking in light means that I say to myself, I'm not perfect. I do sin. I do fall short. But it also means that I'm willing to forsake that sin and confess it and make it right with God. Notice verse 9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Part of walking in the light means I say to myself, look, you do fall short. You do sin. And when I sin, I'm willing to confess that to God. I'm willing to forsake it and repent of it and do what's right. That's what it means to really walk in the light. James 5 verses 16 and 17 says we ought to pray for one another and encourage one another that we may be healed from sin. If that sin is a public sin by public in nature, I need to make it right publicly. If that sin is private, I need to make it right privately to God. Whatever the case, we've got to deal with sin in a God-approved way. Now, something to understand from 1 John 1 verse 9 is this. The word confess doesn't mean that we're going to tell God something He doesn't know. Sometimes I think when we can talk about confessing sin, we're saying, well, God, You may not know this, and I'm about to tell You, though. The word confess in the literal language means to lay alongside of. Well, to lay alongside of what? To lay alongside of what God already knows. God knows our sin. I, when I confess it, am owning up to it, and that's what it means to really walk in the light. Now, why should we continue to confess our sin? Because we do sin. We do fall short. But notice 1 John 2 verse 1 tells us that one of the reasons God gave us the Bible, one of the reasons we have Scripture, is to help us avoid sin in our life so that we can walk in the light. Look at 1 John 2 verse 1. This same theme continues right into chapter 2 when John says, my little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. The Bible was written, my friends, to help us overcome the sin problem. Psalm 119 verses 10 through 12. How can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to your word. Your word I've hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. The Bible helps us understand what sin is and it gives us the plan to overcome sin. God said in Genesis 4 verse 7 to Cain, sin lies at the door. Its desire is for you, but you must master it. Realize today that we can master sin. Oh yes, there are times we fall short. And there is a plan, which is given in verse 2 in just a moment, for dealing with that. But the Bible gives us the way to overcome sin. James 1 verse 22 tells us we're to be doers of the Word, not hearers only, deceiving ourselves. Revelation 12 verse 11, Christians overcame the devil by the word of their testimony, which we have today as the Scripture. Now, to walk in the light means, according to 1 John 2 verses 1 and 2, that we try it best to avoid sin and that we realize Jesus is the propitiation for our sins. If we walk in the light, sees in the light, we've got fellowship one with another. But notice 1 John 2 verse 2 tells us He Himself is the propitiation for our sins and not for ours alone, but for the sins of the whole world. To walk in the light, we've got to realize Jesus paid the ultimate price and I must keep His commandments if I'm going to be faithful to God. Friend, walking in the light doesn't mean you get to do what you want. And it doesn't mean that you can live your lifestyle however you want as long as you claim to be following the teaching of Jesus. People need to understand, walking in the light means we absolutely must obey Jesus. Look in verses 3 through 5 of 1 John 2. Notice this clear teaching. John says, in verse 3, now by this we know that we know Him. How can we know Him? If, notice the condition, if we keep His commandments. He who says, I know Him, and doesn't keep His commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Whoever keeps His word, truly, the love of God is perfected in him. By this we know that we are in Him. Here's how you can know that you're right with God. One of the key words in John's writing is the word know. John wants people to know certain things. You can know you're saved. 1 John 5:13. You can know you're in God. How? If you keep His commandments. Friend, we live in a day and age where many people say, you know, you don't really have to worry about the commandments. It doesn't really matter if you follow exactly what the Bible says. Just love God with all your heart and everything's going to be okay. Friend, that is a false view, a faulty view that is going to cost multiplied millions their eternal soul. And John said, if you say you know Him, you better walk in His commandments. Matthew 7:21 again says, you can't just look up and say, Lord, Lord, and think everything's okay. You've got to do the will of the Father. Here's what Jesus asked in Luke 6:46. Jesus said to the scribes and Pharisees, to the religious leaders, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do the things which I say? What's implied from that? You can't call Jesus Lord, Savior, Master, Owner, and not do what He said. Hebrews 5 verses 8 and 9 tells us why. Jesus is the author of eternal salvation to all those who obey Him. Revelation 22, verse 14, the Bible says, blessed are those who do His commandments. And Ecclesiastes 12, 13 pretty much sums up the purpose of life. Let's hear the conclusion of the whole matter. What's life all about? Fear God. Keep His commandments. This is the whole duty of man. And so to walk in the light, we've got to walk as Jesus walked. To walk in the light, though, also means we've got to love our brothers and sisters in Christ. You know, walking in the light means I follow the teaching of Jesus. It means I have the mind of Christ. But it also means that I've got to be willing to love my brethren in Christ. John spends a great deal of time in 1 John 2 and 3 talking about this idea. He mentions it in 1 John 2, verses 7 through 11, when he goes on to say, you know, if you say you love God and you don't love your brothers and sisters in Christ, then you really don't love God. Friend, a proof of my love for God can be seen in how I treat my brethren. The Bible says in Mark 12, verse 30, that the greatest command is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second, like unto it, is this, love your neighbor as yourself. That's proof of your love for God. A new commandment I give you, Jesus said, that you love one another. As I have loved you, that you also love one another. John 13, verses 34 and 35. And the Hebrew writer emphasized it this way. Let brotherly love continue. If I love God, if I'm going to walk in the light, I must love others. But there's also something I must not love. To walk in the light, Christians must not love the world. I want you to look in 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. Yes, we must love God. Yes, we must love His commandments and love our brethren, but we must abhor the world. Notice this passage. John says in 1 John chapter 2, beginning in verse 15, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away in the lust of it, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. You know, when we think about what real love is, it's loving God, it's loving our brethren, but it's also abhorring, hating that which is worldly. Friend, we cannot have a close relationship with the world, and by that we mean ungodliness and sin and unrighteousness, and expect to be pleasing to God. Sometimes Christians get so caught up in this old world that we can't really see what's important. James described it in probably the most vivid language you could ever imagine. James says, adulterers and adulteresses. Now, I'm expecting some heinous sexual sin in the next few words, but listen to what he says. Adulterers and adulteresses. Do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore desires to make himself a friend of the world has become God's enemy. In such strong language, James shows us that when we get caught up in the world, we have committed spiritual adultery on God. This is why we're to have no fellowship with the world, Ephesians 5 verse 11, in that sense. This is why God said to Christians, come out from among them, who worldly people, and be ye separate. Now friend, as we think about walking in the light, John has a certain problem he's dealing with, and some people are following the wrong light. There are antichrists in the world today, just as there were in John's days. Now, as we think about the Antichrist, some will say that, you know, there's this figure, there's one figure coming who John was predicting in his day, and it's this person. The Antichrist isn't one person. The Antichrist was there in John's time, is here in our time, has always been here, and will always be here. Who is he? Notice 1 John 2, verse 22. This is a very simple teaching in the Bible. John says, who is a liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist, who denies the Father and the Son. Anybody who denies the deity, the divinity, the humanity of Jesus, who denies God the Father and the Son, is Antichrist. And so are we looking for one person, one figure, who's going to one day arise as the Antichrist? No, there are multitudes of them living today. Anybody who denies that Jesus is not God's Son, and anybody who denies that God the Father exists, is against Christ. Friend, I ask you today, are you walking in the light? Right now, are you sure that your path has been illuminated by the teaching of Jesus and that you're walking down the straight and narrow path? This is real important, and here's why. Matthew 7, verses 13 and 14, Jesus said, wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many there are who find it. But narrow is the gate and difficult is the way that leads to eternal life, and few there are who find it. Are you on the straight and narrow path? If not, you can do so today. Believe that Jesus is God's Son. John 8, 24. Be willing to repent of those things in your life that are not right. Luke 13, 1 through 3. Confess the name of Jesus before men. Romans 10, verses 9 and 10. And be baptized in water for the forgiveness of your sins. Acts 2, verse 38. And if you've done those things, then friend, to make it to heaven, you've got to walk in the light as He is in the light, and the blood of Jesus cleanses us of all sin. That means if we've fallen by the wayside as Christians, if we've done things that are not right, we've got to acknowledge that sin, we've got to confess and turn from it, and we've got to strive every day. This is the point John wants us to get. We've got to strive every day to walk in the light of God. May God help us to do just that. You may have just joined our program and are wondering, what is the gospel of Christ? The gospel of Christ is an evangelistic work of the churches of Christ that reaches the whole world with the gospel through TV, radio, and internet. Our motto is to take the whole gospel to the whole world. We believe in having a book, chapter, and verse for everything we say and do. And unlike many religious groups today, we're concerned about lost souls, not your wallet.
And to conquer death.
We encourage you to visit thegospelofchrist.com for a host of Bible study materials as well as audio and video copies of our lessons. If you would like to have a copy of today's lesson, please visit our website and fill out a media request form, or you can email us at mail@thegospelofchrist.com. Call us toll-free at 1-855-458-3905 or write to us at P.O. Box 788, McMinnville, Tennessee, 37111.
And to God be the glory, and to God be the glory, and to God be the glory. This is the gospel of Christ.